So, and then when all the devotees would sit down to take prasadam, no one would take prasadam first until Lord Chaitanya took, and Lord Chaitanya would not take prasadam until all the devotees had their prasadam. He was teaching also how to honor devotees. Okay, I have my prasadam, but what about the rest of them? The prasadam is coming, so we should wait. Everyone's ready, and we begin. And he would take first. So he was teaching in a very exemplary way how to associate with devotees, what is the etiquette for a Vaishnava, and how to serve devotees in so many ways. And there's one verse that is spoken actually by Sanatana Goswami. Sadhu Sangha, Sadhu Sangha, Sarva Sastri Hoy. Lavamata, Sadhu Sangha, Sarva Siddhi Hoy. It says, simply by one moment's association with a great devotee, or a devotee, it doesn't say great devotee, but some devotee, it means pure devotee, one can, lavamata, the word lavamata, lava means 1/11, and mata means second. So if you could divide a second, the smallest, well, the smaller elements of time and seconds, but second is the smallest we know. If you can divide it into 11 parts, it says that one can become purified from all material contamination simply by associating with a devotee a love of metta, with 1/11 of a second. So sometimes we think, oh, the Shastras are just speaking exaggerations. Or they're speaking just to somehow over glorifications. But actually, what that verse means is that if one's consciousness is somewhat in the right state, and one associates with a pure devotee in that proper state of consciousness, that association can purify them. From all material contamination. In other words, all reactions of all sinful activities that have been accumulated for millions of lifetimes are destroyed within an 11th of a second by association with that devotee. So it's powerful how powerful association is. And that question was asked to Srila Prabhupada. Quoting this verse, the devotees asked, how is it possible, Prabhupada, that this could be true? We also have been associating with you, but we can see we're not free from all material contamination. And Prabhupada said that it means that if the wood is wet, it doesn't catch fire. If the wood is wet, it doesn't catch fire. But as soon as the wood dries out, fire immediately starts. So when our consciousness is in the right state, immediately it happens. So how to bring that consciousness to the right state is continual hearing of the philosophy, continual association with the voice, and by, as Prabhupada says, habit is second nature. Habit is second nature. When you have a habit, it's like your second nature. So what he's saying is develop the habit to hear. Jai Sisi Gornitai Ki Jai Radha Kunja Bihari Ji Ki Jai Sivarana Vasta Buddha there. So that consciousness or habit is something that you do without thinking. It just comes by way of what we say of practice, or what we say a particular type of association. So developing the habit to hear can be considered our second nature. So when we practice that habit to hear, in the association with devotees who also want to hear, this is probably the most important quality of a Vaishnava. It's more important to want to hear than it is to speak. Speaking is important, but God gave us one tongue, two ears. So that means hearing is twice as important. You can say that. And when Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati, Prabhupada's Guru Maharaj, was approached by his disciples who wanted to recommend, at that time Prabhupada's name was Abhay, they wanted to recommend him for initiation. They said, "We think he is ready for initiation." Bhakti Siddhanta immediately said, "Yes, I have noted, he likes to hear. He likes to hear." The Prabhupada would say that over and over again. My Guru Maharaj always used to say that about me. And that was my quality. Sometimes I didn't even understand what he was saying. Because if you hear Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati translate his words into your language, only scholars can understand the words. If you read his introduction to the Brahma Samhita, what is that introduction? The materialistic demeanor cannot reach to the transcendental autocrat, which is way beyond one's purview of existence. And he gets into so many big English words that just to get through the introduction, you need a dictionary. But still, even if one doesn't completely understand it, still the process of hearing awakens within one and devotion and purifies one from material sinful activities, from material contamination. So hearing is important, but hearing in the association of Vaishnava is the most important spiritual activity. We see Srimad Bhagavatam starts where one great saint, Sutta Goswami, he has been elected or nominated by the sages, Namisharanya, to what we say, facilitate or to organize, to mitigate the discussion of philosophical topics. And there's 88,000 sages there. It doesn't tell you that, but in the place, another place, it mentions that 88,000 sages came to Namisharanya to discuss philosophical topics. And what was the discussion? Someone would ask a question, and Sutta Goswami would answer the question. And Bhagavatam starts like that. There are six questions. Sutta Goswami is asked six important questions, and then he answers those questions throughout the first chapter, second chapter, and there's one answer in the third chapter of the first canto. And he answers the questions. And those questions are the whole basis of the philosophy, the whole basis of the topics in Srimad Bhagavatam, just those six questions. So there's a way to hear. And we're speaking about association, because association on a spiritual platform means hearing. If one is in physical proximity with others, we also call that association. But the spiritual association in that physical proximity is the desire or the connection with the process of hearing. Because if we're not connected to the sound vibration, even though we're physically associating, we are wherever our consciousness is. So there's one beautiful story. It's in the Bhagavat Mahatmya. Maybe you've seen it. Srimad Bhagavat Mahatmya. It's a little small pink covered book. And it's about a story about one person named I forgot the name. But anyway, this person became a ghost. And he was wanting to get out of his ghostly body. So he was told that you have to hear Srimad Bhagavatam for 7 days by this great saint. And after 7 days, you'll be free from the ghostly body. So they have what is called Bhagavat Saptaha, where a great soul will speak the philosophy of Srimad Bhagavatam in a very systematic way. And people will listen. So this was happening day after day, and many people were coming. Now this one ghost, oh, I can't remember his name, I'll forget it soon. Dundukari, Dundukari. What was the teacher's name?
His brother, his older brother, who was the chanting the
Dundukari. And so he was so eager to get out of this ghost body. He was listening to Srimad Bhagavatam with complete rapt attention in his ghostly body. Whereas other people were also listening. But when the talk was over for that day, he would be thinking the whole night what was said, all the way up until the next day when the next lecture was to start. And so for 7 days continuously, although he wasn't always hearing, he was thinking about what he heard. Whereas others, they were coming and going. And therefore it's mentioned in that narration that because he was so absorbed in Srimad Bhagavatam, he got completely purified. And not only did he get rid of his ghost body, but he attained liberation from material existence. So that's the power of hearing. Now, there's four principles that's mentioned in that story that makes up what is called quality hearing. And there's a verse in the Padma Purana that describes what are these four qualities. Would you like to hear? What are the four characteristics of good hearing? One is faith in the speaker. In other words, one has to have faith in what is being said. Two, one has to be in a mood of humility or submission. Three, one has to destroy the faults of the mind. As you're listening, other thoughts are coming up in the mind. The mind is going to different thoughts. Just like I'm speaking now, you may be thinking about, I wonder if they made the same prasadam as they did last night for tonight again. Or something. You might be thinking of something that is not related to. In other words, the mind goes somewhere. In fact, it can go anywhere. So that's called fault in the mind. The mind is going away from the sound of the vibration of the talk, and therefore that's called dosha. Dosha means faults. So the third step mentioned in that verse is that one has to be diligent to kill these, what we say, wandering thoughts. We'll call the wandering mind going this way and that way to other places. It's the mind definitely wants to wander. You know why? Because it always is wandering. And as soon as we connect with the hearing process, it wants to wander more. Just like you and maybe all of you experienced that when you sit down to chant japa in the morning, you start chanting your rounds, and all of a sudden you find your mind's going everywhere. Why? It's because now you're forcing the mind to be fixed, and the mind says, no. It wants to go this way and that way. And so as soon as you try to tie it down, it's like an animal that's wild. It starts to get more wild. So that's the nature of the mind. But, therefore, one has to be, what the word is, diligent, or where we say, very, very much aware of the wanderings of the mind and bring the mind back to the sound. Bring it back to the sound vibration. And when one destroys the faults in the mind, has faith in the hearer, and is hearing in a very submissive way, number four becomes, what we say, activated. And that is, the mind starts, the intelligence starts to activate and starts thinking of what's being said, and then questions arise in the mind. When one has concentrated hearing, then two things happen. Questions come, or realizations of what is being said also come simultaneously. And that is called perfect hearing. Perfect hearing. Perfect hearing, it stimulates the intelligence in such a way that whatever is being said actually becomes a feature of discussion within your own mind. You start to think about it, you also start to reflect on it, you also maybe start to connect it to something that happened in your own life, like that. So this is active hearing. But it's a process. It doesn't happen automatically. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the third chapter of the first canto, in verse number 43, it mentions in the purport that Prabhupada talks about rapt attention. The word is, in English, R-A-P-T, rapt. Is if you take something and you wrap it up tight, and you wrap it, then it's closed. Nothing else gets in. So attention, when it's wrapped, it's complete. Wrapped attention. And he says this is required in order to practice the process of hearing effectively, perfectly. But he says that to get to rapt attention, one has to be pure in mind. The mind has to be pure or free from anything material. And he says that in order to have pure mind, you have to be pure in your activities also. And then it says that purity of activities means one has to be pure in eating, sleeping, mating, and defending. The bodily activities of life. In other words, the bodily activities of life have to be so regulated and minimized to what is absolutely necessary. And when that is done, the mind is pure, and then attention is, what we say, facilitated to its maximum. But then Prabhupada goes on to say that this is a very difficult state to reach, but still one should practice rapt attention, even though one has not reached that stage of purified consciousness. So, and purified consciousness is interesting in the sense that you get realization. There's a thing called theoretical and what is called realized. Spiritual knowledge is meant to be realized as opposed to theory. Theory means I understand the philosophy, but I don't really practice it according to what I'm hearing. Or the philosophy remains existential or external. But when one becomes purified, then the philosophy actually becomes part of your existence. You actually become like what you read about. And it's not, in other words, your character is becoming transformed. Your personality is developing those qualities that are conducive to spiritual practice. And you're actually acting according to what you're reading or hearing. It's not like it's outside of you anymore. And he explains that this realization comes by practicing the process of hearing. I think many of you all can experience at one time in your life, you've heard something, and all of a sudden, we might use a loose word, lights go on and the bells start ringing, and all of a sudden it makes complete sense. You've heard it 100 times before, but the 101st time you hear it, all of a sudden it hits you. Like, just like we We read over and over again in the scriptures, you are not your body. We know that, right? But do we realize we're not that body? But if you hear it over and over again, and if you hear from a person who is purified in consciousness and is speaking without personal motivation, then when you hear that in the right consciousness, you say, yes, I'm not this body. The yes is not just a confirmation. It is like a realization. What's a realization as opposed to a theoretical principle? A theoretical principle is, you go to a restaurant. This is just a loose example, but this is what I use all the time. You go to the restaurant, you sit down, and you read the menu, and you think, wow, that was a wonderful meal. Whereas the realization is you order it, and then you eat it. As you're eating it, three things are happening. Your hunger is being satisfied, you're finding pleasure in the process of eating, and you're getting nourishment from the eating. Pleasure, nourishment, satisfaction, hunger. Three things. So in the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the 11th canto, there's one verse, I can't remember the exact, 11.2 something. It explains that by devotional service, three things happen. You get transcendental pleasure, you get freedom from material suffering, you get realization of Krishna. Simultaneously, these three things are happening as one is moving forward in the process of devotional service. But it all centers around hearing. Hearing is a feature of devotional service that one can perfect simply by the process. Sometimes we say, and we say this quite often, that all the other nine processes, chanting, remembering, serving, serving the lotus feet, offering prayers, worshipping the Lord in the form of the deity, becoming a friend to the Lord, and surrendering everything, is situated on the process of hearing. Before you can chant, you have to hear. Before you can remember, you also have to hear. Before you can offer prayers, you hear. Before you worship, you also hear how to worship. So hearing is fundamental to all the processes of devotional service. But hearing itself is a process in itself. We have the example in Srimad Bhagavatam. Maharaj Parikshit, he was so absorbed in wanting to hear that he forgot all his bodily needs. He forgot to eat. He forgot to sleep. He didn't even drink water until he was reminded, oh, you need some water. He was so absorbed in hearing. Of course, he was told he only had 7 days to live. He was cursed to die, because apparently he had committed some offense, which he didn't. But anyway, that's another part of the story. But the point was that he was so absorbed in hearing that all he could, his whole existence was simply hearing. It was like all the nourishment he needed. It was like his food, his water, his sleep, his happiness, everything was coming simply by hearing the glories of the Lord, spoken by Sukadeva Goswami. Sukadeva Goswami was a pure Vaishnava. Not only pure, he was on the highest platform of devotion. He was a Paramahansa. I mean, he was not only realizing the philosophy, he was associated with Krishna constantly, 24 hours a day.